good and gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day, Lord. I just thank you, Lord, for Jesus. Lord, healer, redeemer. Lord, you just, words can't describe you, Lord God, and the grave couldn't hold him. So we just praise you and thank you for that, Lord. We just pray over this this service here this morning, this word. Lord, that people hear you, not me. I'm nothing. You are the great I am. So, Lord God, we just praise you this morning and thank you and pray in Jesus' name. They all said,
amen.
Amen. Holiness. Man, can you wrap your head around that word, Michael?
No.
No. Holiness. I've been trying to pursue and practice holiness. Do you know how hard that is?
I got a lot of room for improvement.
Amen. Amen. I found out, Michael, I do too. So I don't care who you are. We got a lot of work to do. And I just want to spend a little bit of time and look at holiness, just a little bit this morning, and what that looks like. Holiness starts for us in Jesus Christ. And we can't get away from that. There's no getting away. There's no other way. It starts for us in Jesus Christ and receiving him and accepting him and being born again. That's where holiness starts. It's the beginning. It starts. So if you're here today and you're a believer in Jesus Christ, this message is for you. If you're here today and you don't know Jesus, I hope that you get to know Jesus through this message. Because I'll tell you what, this little cross right here, it's mighty. It's mighty. And I'll get to that here a little later on. But if we look at holiness, and for the Israelites, it started in the Old Testament, and we have to go back and look at the start and what God did for his people. And if you want to look at that, you go over to Leviticus. How many of people have just read Leviticus this week, last week? Have you ever just sat and read Leviticus? Oh, man. Well, all right. But you know what? I read Leviticus. You know? Yeah, good for me. It hurt me. It hurt. But and I'm not going to bore you with the whole message of Leviticus, but you got to know that if you're a Christian, you know, you got to remember it says, be holy because I am holy. You know where that first come from?
Leviticus.
Amen. You know who quoted it in the new scripture? Peter. Peter quoted that piece of scripture. So what I want to do first is I want to bore you with Leviticus chapter 19. And it's a good start. And then I promise you, I'm going to give you about an 11-minute break. We're going to watch a little video. And we're going to see how holiness affects us, the Christian. So you're going to have a break. It's going to take me a little bit to get through it. So if you got your Bibles, share with me. Now, I'm not going to take you to chapter 12 because there's a whole bunch of rules and regulations in there, too, that the Israelites were to follow. But we're just going to look at 19, and it's a lot. And don't be offended. There's some things, or some offensive things that are in this piece of scripture that some of us, we might have participated in this or done this, but remember who you are in Christ Jesus. Remember, you are free. We don't live by the law anymore, but we need to know what the law says. Amen? So in Leviticus chapter 19, the Lord said to Moses, speak to the entire assembly of Israel and say to them, be holy because I am holy, because I, the Lord your God, am holy. Each of you must respect your mother and father, and you must observe my Sabbaths. I am the Lord your God. And you're going to hear the Lord your God several times in this piece of scripture. It says, do not turn to idols or make metal gods for yourselves. I am the Lord your God. When you sacrifice a fellowship offering to the Lord, sacrifice it in such a way that it will be accepted on your behalf. It shall be eaten on the day of your sacrifice, or on the next day. Anything left or until the third day must be burned up. If any of it is eaten on the third day, it will be impure and not accepted. And I'm very hot up here. Whew, my. Whoever eats it will be held responsible because they have desecrated what is holy to the Lord, and they must be cut off from their people. In verse 9 it says, when you reap the harvest of your land, do not reap it to the very edges of your field or gather the gleanings of the harvest. Do not go over the vineyard a second time or pick the grapes that have fallen. Leave them for the poor and the foreigner. I am the Lord your God. He says, do not steal. Do not lie. Do not deceive one another. Do not swear falsely by my name and so profane the name of your God. I am the Lord. Do not defraud or rob your neighbor. Do not hold back the wages of a hired worker overnight. He goes on to say, do not curse the deaf or put a stumbling block in front of the blind, but fear the Fear your God. I am the Lord. Do not pervert justice. Do not show partiality to the poor or favoritism to the great, but judge your neighbors fairly. Do not go about spreading slander among your people. Do not do anything that endangers your neighbor's life. I am the Lord. Do not hate a fellow Israelite in your heart. Rebuke your neighbor frankly so you will not share in his guilt. Do not seek revenge or bear a grudge against any among your people, but love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. Keep my decrees. Do not mate in different kinds of animals. Do not plant your field with two kinds of seed. Do not wear clothing woven to kinds of material. It goes on and it goes on and it goes on and it goes on about righteous living the best they could. And you have to understand in this scripture what has happened here. These people have, they came out of bondage. They lived in a pagan land. They were full of pagan idols. And God wanted to have these Israelites set apart from these folks. That he did not want his people looking like the ordinary pagan Joe over there. And so he gave them all these rules and regulations. He used Moses. He laid all this stuff on him. And I don't know how, well, they couldn't keep it very well. They had problems. They had issues with a lot of stuff. If you read the rest of the story in the Old Testament, it was just incredible. It was just how they tried to do it. And they did it to the best of their ability, you know, and they tried, but it was impossible, you know, but it was important. And it's important if you think about holiness, because that's what holiness is. If you look at holiness, it's set apart by God to God. And it says totally devoted to God. If you look up in the dictionary what holiness says, totally devoted to God. How many in here are holy? Raise your hands if you're saved, you're holy. Are you totally devoted to God? Praise God. You're totally devoted. Praise God. Amen. Okay, we're going to hear the rest of the story. Totally devoted to God. In the holiness, in the highest sense, it belongs to God. Travis is set apart. He's holy, but he's not God. He can't say that I am God, because that's a holiness that's for God. And it says that it belongs to God. And to Christians, is consecrated to God's service. And so far as they are conformed in all things to the will of God. We look at God's perfect and pleasing will. And we're going to look at some of these scriptures and what we're called to do. And if you want to look that up, it's in Romans 6:19, Ephesians 1:4, Titus 1:8, 1 Peter 1:15. Personal holiness is a work of gradual development. Amen? Gradual. Kim, you're not going to get holiness overnight. It's not going to happen. You know, I've been around Mary. She's been set apart for a lot of years, but she's not all that holy all the time. But neither am I. So it's just the way it is. You know, you live with us a while, you'll see, and in your home, that's where you see how holy you are. But God has set us apart. We need to be holy in our homes. That's where we need to, that's where we have a lot of influence in our homes. Remember that, Dave, Sherry, when you're raising them babies, that you need to be holy, because what are you doing? You're teaching these young people, boom, boom, boom. We all have that. We all have that responsibility to be holy. And it goes on to say, it is carried on under many hindrances. I like that. There's some hindrances in there. Hence, frequent admonitions to watchfulness, prayer, and perseverance. You know what? And people ask me all the time, well, why do I need to go to church? Why do I need to be a part of a church? And I'll tell you why you need to be part of a church: because of holiness. You set yourself apart, and you're not part of a body of believers. And it's scriptural, and it's in Hebrews, and the writer talks about it in Hebrews, why it's important, because we need one another. Janie needed the one another's. She needed us. She's gonna need us. And this is for a situation for help, for prayer, and also we need one another for accountability. Amen? Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. We got to have that amen, because we all need to be held accountable. That's all there is to it. And we need one another. Not that we want to be prideful of it. Jacob reminded me that when we're with holiness, he goes, well, you got to be humble too, because you know what? I've been in the midst of some holy rollers that come with the book and the wonderful word of God that had no sin in their life, and they were proud to tell everybody about it and tell you how you should live and what you should do. You know what? That just turned me off. They were missing. They might have been holy, but they weren't humble. in doing so. So, and now, and what I want to do now is we set the stage. We've seen where it come from Leviticus. Now I want to see, we're going to see a little video, and it's going to take about 11 minutes to get through this video. Some of you probably have already seen this. You're going to have to suffer through it. But this is what holiness looks like, as long as Robert can get it to play, in a Christian's life. In a born again, this is the born again believer. Turn two lights off, man.
Ephesians 2:10 says that we are God's workmanship, His masterpiece.
That's good.
I don't know about you, but when I get up in the morning and look in the mirror, I don't really see a masterpiece, you know? I mean, maybe a Picasso. It's like, but I want to be His masterpiece. I want to be everything He created me to be. And so I go to Him in prayer and I say, Dear Heavenly Father, do whatever it takes to mold me into the image of Your Son. Make me Your masterpiece. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Hi.
Whoa. Who are you?
I'm God. You said the prayer, so here I am.
You're not God.
No, I am. You said the prayer. That's how it works.
Okay. If you're God, then make it snow in here.
You know what? I really don't want to make it snow in here because it'd get kind of yucky.
Yeah, you're not God.
Why do you say that?
God wouldn't say yucky.
I do. It's a Greek word.
Oh, okay. If you're God, what does Lamentations 15:9 say?
Lamentations is only 5 chapters. It's a very short book.
Oh, why was it so short?
I was tired of lamenting.
Oh, okay. If you're God, who's going to win the World Series this year?
I'm really not into playing games. Why are you so much into playing games?
You are God.
Well, gave it away.
You answered my question with a question.
I did? Yeah, I do that. Don't I? I did it again. Step right up. Here we go.
Okay.
All right.
Hey, what are we doing?
I'm going to make you into my original masterpiece. This is the process.
Oh, okay. Got it.
Yeah.
Wait. What are these about?
These are the tools I'm going to use to make you into my original masterpiece.
Okay. Yeah. Hang on.
Yeah.
I thought you were a carpenter.
That's my son. Step right up. Here we go.
Okay. Oh, hey, God.
Mm-hmm.
How do you know what to chisel away and what to leave?
I take out everything in your life that doesn't belong there, kind of like dead weight.
Ooh, speaking of dead weight, could you chisel right here? It showed up when I was in my 20s and grew around and became back fat. I don't even know why you created that, but I can't get rid of it. I mean, I've tried everything. Like, I tried running, I tried lifting weights. My wife actually talked me into trying Pilates. That was awkward, but I can't get rid of it. So if you would just chisel around here, and then, you know what, if you chisel a line right here and maybe 4 to 5, maybe 8 lines right here. That would be awesome.
You're funny.
You made me that way.
I also made the platypus.
The platypus.
All I'm saying is most of my children, when it comes to this process, they just want to talk, but they don't want to do the work. So do you want to talk or can I chisel? Talk, chisel.
No. I choose to chisel.
All right. Through my Holy Spirit, I'm going to bring up things in your life that I want you to work on. Like your anger. I created the emotion, but you use it in the wrong way. You compare yourself to others instead of me. You tell little white lies because you want to people please. You're lazy. But you try to fool everybody by looking really, really busy. You have a problem with lust? Well,
time out. I don't really have a problem with lust.
You don't have a problem with lust.
No, I can do it anytime I want. Hang on a second. I mean, I got to admit, I feel like you've been doing some great work, and I'm looking pretty good right now.
All right, when you look in the mirror, who do you see?
I see me.
Okay, then I need to keep chiseling away because ultimately you and other people need to see my son.
Okay, don't misunderstand me. It's just when I look more like Jesus, people get uncomfortable around me. I mean, even my church friends, and they're like, oh, you're holier than thou, you know? And I don't think I'm supposed to make people uncomfortable.
So what you're saying is you'd rather play God in certain areas of your life than for me to be God over your whole life.
That is not what I said.
It's what you meant.
Yes, it is. It's hard to talk to you. You know everything that I'm thinking. I'm just saying you've done some great work. Maybe we take a break, a sabbatical from each other, you know. I'll stay right here and then, you
know. That's just it. You never just stay right there. You're either moving toward me or away from me, but never you just stay. What you're doing is called control. Do you want to control things in your life or can I chisel? Control, chisel, control,
chisel. No, chisel.
All right.
But can we chisel where I want?
That's called control.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry.
Now this right here, this secret sin that you keep running to whenever you're hurting, angry, lonely, tired, that you think you're fooling everybody, but it's making you a whitewashed tomb. Are you ready for me to chisel this out of your life?
Yeah.
See, it's a process. It's not a sprint, it's a marathon. It's your whole life. And you care so deeply about what other people think of you. It's rubbish. It's garbage. The greatest thing you're ever going to hear is at the end of your life when you hear me say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." That's what you keep your eye on. That's the prize. Heavenward.
Oh, that hurts.
Oh, trust me. This hurts me more than it hurts you.
Right.
Okay. I'm sorry. I don't think you understand this pain.
Pardon me?
You're asking me to sacrifice a lot, God.
Don't talk to me about sacrifice. I know all about sacrifice. I sent my son to die on the cross for pain, for sin, but I also did it for another reason, to give you freedom. Do you know what insanity is? Insanity is doing the same thing over and over and over again, expecting different results. And there are things that you've been doing for years. These empty wells that don't have anything to offer. You've been going to them and it's insane. Allow me to chisel them out of your life. Allow me to produce character where you keep focusing so much on your image.
Okay, but I was thinking.
Your thoughts are not my thoughts.
Okay, but if we went another way.
Your ways are not my ways.
Oh, I can't.
You can't what?
I can't be good.
That's your excuse. That's your excuse, is that you can't be good.
It's not an excuse. I can't.
Oh, my child. In the beginning, I said it was good. I made you good. Be good.
Yeah, but you and I both...
What?
Nothing.
No, what is it?
Nothing, okay? You wouldn't understand.
I, God of all the universe, wouldn't understand something one of my children has to say. Try me.
It's just, I let you down so many times, God.
No, my child. You were never holding me up. I hold you up with my victorious, righteous right hand. Never the other way around. In this relationship, I hold you up.
Okay. And chisel away. But just be prepared for what you're going to find in there. Because I know who's inside there. Because I get up every morning and I look at him in the mirror and I hate who I see. Because deep inside there, this little kid who gets up every morning and dresses like an adult. And I go out and I try to do what I'm supposed to do, but I can't, okay? I can't be who everybody else expects me to be. God, I can't even be who I want to be, much less who you created me to be. And so inside is this scared, stupid little kid. But you chisel away, just be prepared.
You have listened to so many voices for far too long that were not from me. And you have totally bought into the lie, haven't you? You think you're junk, don't you? When you lay your head down at night after you've done the dance to get the hug, you think you're junk. Listen to me. I don't take time to make junk. How can I show you that my love for you stretches as far as the east to the west? How can I show you that my love for you has no end? I know. Reach in your back pocket.
What?
Reach in your back pocket.
Why?
Are you arguing with me? Reach in your back pocket.
Oh, God.
Yes?
I just meant, God, I'll do that right now.
You're just saying my name in vain.
Come on, it's a name, it's a saying.
It's a name above all names.
Amen.
It's more than a saying, it's more than a name. I want to teach you something about my name. Reach in your back pocket.
Oh my God. Shh.
You know what that is?
Yeah, it's a note. I wrote it when I was in college. How did you get this?
Hello?
Oh yeah.
Go ahead, read it.
I love Angie.
Other side.
Dear God, did I hear you right today? Did I hear you say that you love me? You
even though you and I both know I messed up so many times. Did I hear you say you want to use me? I feel so useless. If you'll take me and use me, then God, I give you all that I am. Take me. I love you, God.
I love you too. And I love you too much just to leave you where you're at. This salvation that you hold, I don't want it to be some sentimental gush or some head knowledge. I want you to work it out in every detail of your life. And when problems come and chaos happens, don't look at it as a prison, but look at it as a father disciplines his child. A father disciplines the ones he loves.
I know, but it's going to be tough.
Yes, but you bought into the lie thinking everything was going to be easy when you gave everything over to me. There will be trouble in this world, but be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. I want you to do something. I want you to look out there and I want you to say, Tommy is God's original masterpiece.
Tommy is God's.
No, not the way you see yourself or you try so desperately for others to see you, but maybe for the first time in your life, the way I see you, the way I created you.
Tommy is God's original masterpiece.
Yes, you are.
Amen. And so are you. God doesn't make junk. You are an original masterpiece.
Praise God. You know what? I can relate to that guy. You know, as I pursue holiness, and I'm just talking about me, you know, my wife and I, because I asked her, I says, Mary, will you pursue holiness with me? And you know what? I've realized in my life that there's sin that I don't want chiseled out, or I don't want to let God in, you know, but that's what it takes. It hurts. It hurts to get rid of some of that stuff, but that's what God wants in us as we pursue holiness. And here's what the Bible says about that in the New Testament. I want you to see in the New Testament, it says, Hebrews 12:14, it says, make every effort to live in peace with everyone and to be holy. Without holiness, no one will see the Lord. Ephesians 1:4 says, for he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. 1 Thessalonians 3:13, may he strengthen your hearts so that you will be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus comes with all his holy ones. 1 Thessalonians 4:7, for God did not call us to be impure, but to live a holy life. 2 Timothy 1:19, he has saved us and called us to a holy life, not because of anything we have done. Get that, not because of anything we have done, but because of his own purpose and grace. This grace was given us in Christ Jesus before the beginning of time. 1 Peter 1:14-16, as obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you have when you lived in ignorance, but just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. That's God's call for the church, is to be holy and to pursue holiness. That's the call for each and every one of us. And to have holiness means that we put on and we put off. There's garbage in every one of our lives that have to be put off for us as we pursue holiness. And you know what it is. I don't have to tell you all about it. I don't have to read your mail or anything else. You know what it is. God knows what it is. And the only stop and the only problem is me, myself, and I. That's the problem. We get in the way of that holiness. And I want to look at Ephesians 4 and 5, and Paul lays it out very well as he writes his scripture to this church. And if you go over there in 4, and we'll start, let's just start in verse 17, and the title is Instructions for Christian Living. It's a how-to. It's a New Testament deal here that Paul is speaking to Christians in the church in Ephesus, and he lays it all out for them. He tells them what they need to be doing and bringing all this and bringing all this sin up in their lives that's no doubt going on. It says, "So I tell you this and insist on it in the Lord, that you must no longer live as Gentiles do in the futility of their thinking. They are darkened in their understanding and separated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them due to the hardening of their hearts. Having lost all sensitivity, they have given themselves over to sensuality and so indulge in every kind of impurity, and they are full of greed." Verse 20, that however is not the way of life you learn when you heard about Christ and were taught in him in accordance with the truth that is in Jesus. You were taught with regards to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your mind. Leroy, there's that scripture right there in the attitude of their mind. Sin starts right here in the old coconut. Right here, you start thinking about something, you dwell upon something, and you allow the devil to take a foothold. We talked about that this morning. You're thinking. The Bible says in Romans 12, 1 and 2, it says, "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship. Do not be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." The renewing of your mind, that's where it starts for the Christian. We got to renew. Our minds have to be renewed. We have to start thinking. We have to start thinking clearly. We have to start thinking good thoughts. Think no more stinking thinking, because that's what it all was. In the old Paul, there was some crazy, stupid, stinking thinking that went on, and a lifestyle that was just leading to destruction and ruining my whole family. But praise be unto God for Jesus Christ. When I was 38 years old, I come to the end of myself and give it all to him and said, Mike and I talked about it this morning. It's, Lord, you can have it. What a deal we got. You know, he got my mess. He got everything. He got garbage. And I got grace, mercy, and Jesus Christ. And praise be unto God, man, that's a deal that anybody should take. If you are in this church and you haven't taken that deal, you are a fool. And that's what the Bible says. You're a fool. Because it's in Christ Jesus, that's where the healing begins. If you got sin, you know where it begins? Boom, Jesus Christ will help you with that. Amen? That's what the church is for. That's what Celebrate Recovery is for. That's what ministry is for, to help people out of their garbage and into the light. And it's praise God that he's allowing us to do that. Praise God that he's put a group of believers together passionately wanting to seek and help others and love our neighbors and love everyone. Amen? His good and perfect pleasing will. He goes on to say, we got through the thinking in our minds to put on the new self, to be created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Therefore, each of you must put off falsehood and speak truthfully. What did Leviticus say? Quit lying. You know what? And that includes the little white lies we tell not to hurt somebody's feelings. And I'm guilty. Guilty as charged. You know what? No more. I'm not going to go out of my way to help and hurt anybody, but you know what? I'm not going to enable anybody either. You know what? That's something that I'm bad about. I'm a people pleaser. I'm a pastor. I want you to feel good. You know what? I'm going to preach God's word, and if it hurts you, I'm sorry. I don't mean to do that, but you have to take it up with God, because if I'm going to be holy, if I'm going to pursue holiness, that's part of the chiseling. That's got to drop off of me. And it's got to drop off every one of us. And he goes on to say, falsehood, speak truthfully to your neighbor and for all members of one body. If you're in your anger, do not sin. If you're struggling with angriness and what Kaylee talked about that, you know what? Boom, it's got to go. Because I'll tell you what, there is nothing more depressing or more ugly than an angry Christian. That is awful. And I've seen them. You know, self-righteous, angry people that never put it off. Christians, that's got to go. It's got to go. The Bible says it's got to go. The anger has got to go. I dealt with anger. You know, I was an angry person, but it's gone. Praise be unto God, it's gone. Now, I get angry once in a while, but you know what? I don't get angry very often. I don't practice anger. It's gone. And it says, do not let the sun go down while you are still angry, and do not give the devil a foothold. Anyone who has been stealing, steal no longer. If you're a thief, you're stealing, quit it. Stop it. You know what? And if I'm a JB Marine and I don't think it's going to hurt to take a pad of paper or a pencil, you know what? It's wrong. It's stealing. You know what? And I'll tell you right now, and you can ask Becky up there. When I buy something through the company, I make sure that, and my wife will show you checks where I write checks back to JB Marine. Nobody would ever know it that I did that. But you know, God knows it, and I know it, and it was wrong. It's wrong for me to do that. You know what? If my boss wants to give me a gift, I'll take it. But I'm not going to take it on my own because I don't deserve it. You know, when my boss pays me on a Friday, that's my reward for doing a good job for him and being a godly man at JB Marine. And it says, and it goes on to say, steal no longer, but must work. Do something useful with your hands, and that you may have something to share with those in need. We need to all get some jobs. Mary started a new job. She needs to work because we need to do some more sharing. You know, and some people are in a position. Kaylee's in a position. She's got a baby to raise. That's her job right now, you know. So, and that's an important job for her to do, and she needs to do it well. It's not my responsibility to teach Jairus God's word and everything else. Now, I want to step in alongside and encourage, but that's Jacob, and that's Kaylee's job. It was my job to do that with my children, and I did it, but something went awry. You know, there was some garbage back there. Now, you know, I've got two lost children that I'm believing and knowing that God's going to bring into the kingdom, because there was some good seed that was sown into their lives. And I know and I believe that they're saved. They're just waiting like their dad. Same way with me. I was 38 when I got saved. I had a father that taught me some very good principles and some wonderful good stuff, but he never seen me saved. But you know what? I might not see my kids, but I know one day my babies are going to be saved, and they're going to be with me in the kingdom one day. Says, oh, here's a tough one. You know, I don't know about you guys, but do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouth. You know, I've heard some Christians let some cuss words fly. You know, and quite regularly. And whoo, I sat back. Wait a minute. But those are things that need to be chiseled out of their lives. You know, my old pastor used to say, if God convicts you of something, you do it. And if he don't, you don't deal with it. Well, I tell you what, God does not want us Christian men out there cursing, looking at garbage, being in foolish conversations, sitting around while somebody's telling a dirty joke and laughing at it. We need to be set apart because God wants us to be set apart. We don't need to look like the world. The world's got enough problems. Believe me, if you read the news this morning, some kook went into a nightclub and killed 50 people in Orlando, Florida this morning. 50 people estimated die. Some guy went in there with a gun and killed them.
Man.
We got to be ready. We got to be ready, but we got to be Christ-like. I pray for that man that did that. What a tormented man and mind he was, and I pray for the individuals that suffered the consequences of his sin. And it says, but only what is helpful for building up others according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, in whom you are sealed for the day of redemption. Here we go. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, brawling, slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as Christ God forgave you. It goes on in chapter 5, follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love. Just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and a sacrifice to God. And I'm going to read just a little bit more because he goes on in verse 3. He says, but be it among you, there must not even be a hint of sexual immorality or any other kind of impurity or greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. Nor should there be any obscenity, for foolish talk or coarse joking, which are out of place, but rather thanksgiving. For of this you can be sure, no immoral, impure, or greedy person, such a person is an idolater, has any inheritance in the kingdom of God. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of such things, God's wrath comes on those who are disobedient. Therefore, do not be partners with them. Those are God's words. You know what? I'm not judge and jury, and thank God I'm not for all of you, because you would all be in trouble. But I praise God for a good and righteous God that loves us and cares for us and knows our hearts. He knows what needs to be chiseled. He knows what doesn't need to be chiseled. Travis, can you come up here for a minute? I'm going to have Travis play a song. And I got these little crosses here. I can't share much about it, but this year, when we do it quite often at CR, we give out chips. And the reason a lot of this is we're teaching about crossroads. And everybody comes to a crossroad in their life. You know, I was 38 years old when I came to my crossroad. There was a road that I come to, and the road that I was on led to death and destruction. And I didn't quite know about this other road, but I was very grateful that somebody took some time and explained it to me, and that God showed up and put me on the right road. Am I done? No. I'm on that road, but I'll tell you what, there's still stuff, like I tell you all the time, is it's like a plane wreck. You know, when it goes down, there's a debris field a mile behind. You get what I'm saying, Mark? There's a debris field. There's stuff that fell off in my life. And I got news for you, there's more stuff that needs to go. As I pursue holiness, as Mary and I pursue holiness, because two are one, and us two, really, we want to do this together and to pursue holiness. And you know what? It can be done. It can absolutely be done. You know what? And if you're here this morning and you know what? You're dealing with anger, maybe that's what that's keeping you from being holy. Maybe you do have a filthy mouth or different things that you struggle with. If that's you this morning, as Travis plays this song, or maybe, you know what, you need this cross. You've never said, Lord, I can't do this on my own. You need Jesus Christ. That's where you got to start if you want to become holy. That's just the beginning. I've been on this walk for quite a while. And you know what? Paul still got to pick up a cross. I still needed a blue chip, you know, because I fall short of the glory of God. Everybody in here falls short of the glory of God. Praise be unto God for Jesus Christ that died for my sins. But that doesn't mean he wants me just, and it just drives me nuts because people get saved and I can talk anybody and call people to come down the aisle and pray a wonderful prayer. But you know what? You know what you dealt with in your heart, you know. When the first time I walked down an aisle in a church, I walked up to join the church. And I said the right thing, and before you know it, boom, they said I was saved. And they were baptizing me and everything else, but probably about 3 months later, when I got into God's Word, I became born again. My life was changed forever. And there's no going back. There's no going back to that old lifestyle. And you know what? I'm not there yet, but you know what? It's been a wild ride. And it's been awesome. It's been a great ride. And God has put many good, godly men and women into my life to teach me, to help me, to hold me up. You know, and that's what we need. We need one another. So if you're here in this church this morning and you got some sin in you, I don't need to hear about it. If you want to come onto this altar and pray, pick up your little cross if you want, and it's just a little reminder that I need to work on anger. Lord, I don't need to be tempted by that anymore. You know what? I got the cross. I got the blood of Jesus Christ covering me, and I need help with that. And boom, I guarantee you God will help you. So if you're here this morning when Travis plays this song, and you want to come up here and get across, you don't have to confess your sin to me. I don't care to hear it. Confess it to God. You know what you've done or what you need to do. You know what things in your life that you, and maybe you're just sitting there thinking about it, and God will just bring something. That's the Holy Spirit working in your life. Don't deny the Holy Spirit. So many people, they hear it, but they just don't do anything about it. And we're stuck. You know what? And that's not a good place to be, is stuck. There's freedom, and it's in Christ Jesus, because he is the Alpha and the Omega. And you know what? Just like that little video, I can't preach it that well, but that's what God does. I love them guys, because it's just a perfect picture of the church. Our church is not perfect. There's no perfect church in this world. You know what? We're all hopefully pursuing holiness, that we can become better, that we can become good, bold, solid witnesses for Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen.
Holiness, holiness is what I long for. Holiness is what I need. And holiness, holiness is what you want.
Holiness, holiness.
what you want from me.
Thank you all this morning. I hope God touched all your hearts here this morning. And if he did, it was God. It wasn't me. You know what? But I pray that you pursue holiness. And Allegra, you need something to say something? Okay. Amen. So praise God. I want you to do me a favor too. You know, sometimes we get in the hustle and bustle of things, but I want you, I got a stark reminder this week is don't take anyone for granted. Care who you are, who they are, if it's your child, if it's your husband, it's your wife, tell them you love them and how much they mean to you, you know, because you don't know. You just don't know when you're going to get that opportunity again, you know. I did that. I learned a lesson long ago in life, and I was 19 and my brother Jim was 18, and I had a terrible fight with him, and he was, the last time I seen him, he was laying on a gurney, and they were keeping him alive so they could transplant his organs. I never got to say I'm sorry. I never got to apologize to him. I never got to say I loved him. You know, God healed that hurt in my heart, and I've gone on from that. You know what? But I learned a valuable lesson there. I don't keep no record of wrongs. Keep no record of wrongs. Amen? Travis, will you close us in prayer?
Lord, thank you for the encouragement of holiness. And Lord, just... it is difficult. It's hard to surrender things sometimes. It's hard to give things up and hard to let go of control. Lord, help us to do that today. Help us to let you have control and do what you want to do. Guide us through this week, Lord. Continue to develop, as you develop holiness in us, that you're using us also to develop holiness in others and to point them to you. So Lord, we commit ourselves to you, God, that you would have your way in and through us this week for your name's sake. Amen.
Praise God. Y'all have a great week. And also, we're coming up here, we're doing Exodus on Thursday night, but we are going to do a study and lesson on holiness, and it's going to really be good. Pastor Joe's got all the information. It's going to be a video series, and we're looking forward to it. It'll be upcoming. I will let you know. But something we all need to strive for and pursue. Thank you all very much, and God bless. Have a great day. Don't overheat out there. Drink plenty of water, Jacob.